A real pleasure to be here to discuss our real-time trend trading experiment. And we've got more content than time, so I'm gonna get right into it. Just 10 seconds on my background. My passion for trading began when I was about 7 playing Pong. And I was a product of the golden age of video gaming. As you might know from video games, what you're trying to look for are patterns and asymmetrical risk reward opportunities. I guess I got pretty good at it because in 1983 at the Vancouver Computer Fair, I beat out 1,000 other kids on a new video game release, and I won a Commodore VIC-20 computer, launching a lifetime career in programming and developing. Growing up in Vancouver, I was interested in the Vancouver Stock Exchange, but in 1999, that was called the Scam Capital of the World by Forbes. I was interested in some of the classical technical analysis things like stochastics, things I really don't believe too much in these days at all. But I felt I had to get my butt to Chicago to work on the floor at the Board of Trade before it too went electronic, as I saw happen on the Vancouver Stock Exchange. So I moved to Chicago in 1991. First thing I'll tell you on the floor is to read a couple of books, Reminiscences of Stock Operator and Market Wizards. If you haven't already, you definitely should. Somewhere along the way though, I learned the techniques for trading that I'm going to describe today in part. So Totem Asset Group, we provide alternative investment solutions for qualified eligible persons. If you are one of those, I'd love to chat with you at some point. I put my thoughts together in a book that may be of interest. I created a networking group. We grew from 4 people to 2,000. If anyone's listening out there, I can't wait to see you guys all again. And onto the experiment here. So every minute of every trading day for the past 5 years, what we've been doing is taking trades from cradle to grave and publishing the results. We've got a lot of interest recently. The blue line here is what's been happening during this global virus crisis, as we're starting to call it now. And the yellow line, I don't know if you can see, but the blue line, my mouse there, I don't think you can see, but if you can, you can see how as the stocks have been going down, our project has been going up. And the green line is this SocGen CTA index, which has been really flatline. Here's a bigger picture view, and we've made new 5-year all-time highs with this recent move, and I'm going to explain why and how. So obligatory risk disclosure, please, this is not investment advice. Trading futures is risky. Consult your financial advisors, and you need to do your own homework. We're also going to talk about hypothetical trades, things that we've made a timestamp of, but we're not affected in the market. So there's definitely drawbacks to that type of approach, but there are also some pros as well. Quick history, for those of you that don't know this really amazing story, these two wealthy traders in the 80s had a disagreement, let's say. Were great traders born with a natural killer instinct, or could they be taught? So they put it to the test. They put an ad in the Wall Street Journal and Barron's, a call for trading apprentices. From tens of thousands of applicants, they took 13. You can take the original entrance exam that they used right from our website. So I was lucky enough to be exposed to some of their techniques in 1993, and I've kind of started to begin my journey, and hopefully you can too. You can read about their turtle trading experiment in any one of Michael Covell's book or Curtis Faith's book, Market Wizards, etc. In fact, when you're one short Google search away from getting the original turtle trading rules that were in part basing the 40 in, 20 out model off of. This is important because of the CTA community, many of them are self-proclaimed to be trend traders. Now, it's arguable what percentage that is these days, but that's a whole other discussion. And the reason you want managed futures in your portfolio is because with the tendency by adding lowly correlated assets to your portfolio, the tendency is to increase returns while reducing risk. We have to talk about alpha. On this chart here, we have the gold standard benchmark performance in the gold line. And then we have some funds performance in blue. And there will be, at sometimes the fund will outperform and sometimes it will underperform. We call those generating positive alpha and negative alpha versus the beta. So the beta would be the benchmark. Here's an example of Grandma gave you 500 shares of Apple every on the first day of every year. So I bought 500 shares of Apple. I sold it at the end of the year. I made 2017, you made 26,000. If you instead took that money and bought Spiders, which would be the S&P 500 equivalent, you would have only made 10,700. So we'd say that Apple generated positive alpha that year. The very next year, Apple generated negative alpha. It lost a little more money than the market did. And then last year, it made a heck of a lot more, generating massive positive alpha vis-a-vis the market in general. So when you're talking about a hedge fund trading stocks, it's really easy to compute alpha because you're using the S&P 500. It's more difficult for a CTA or a CTA type strategy because we have so many different indices to choose from. Who are the components? What are their weightings? What are they doing? These are all open-ended questions, which makes it very difficult. So we created this project to create a classic CTA trend beta, something that was very transparent. We want a high level of accountability by publishing the trades. It should be easily understood. Now, key point here, it's suboptimal. This is not a strategy I trade per se, but it's not a bad strategy. The whole point here is to educate investors on trend trading concepts and help them to begin their investigation and their journey. So whether you're a grizzled vet, a young quant student, or just a passive investor, it's for you. The number one question we get, why the name 40 and 20 out? Hopefully that'll be clear in a minute. Now, I'm gonna run through this really quick, but it's an adaptation of a seminar we held for a family office for their kids. And we said, why are you guys here? What three things matter to me? Are price. Everything, it's a basic tenet of technical analysis, is everything you need to know is embedded within the price. Forecasts, supply, demand. Everything you need to know is in the price. So by analyzing price over time, you're analyzing all the factors that go into prices. And then I told the kids, I go, why are you guys here? Why are you spending all this money on a college education? It's to get the money. And how are you gonna do that? There's only one way. You need to create an actionable order, something that can be plugged into the computer. I asked them to draw a quick chart here with price and time. And I told them I'm gonna read them a bunch of numbers. You're gonna fill in a dot to dot plot, much like this, make a line chart. I told them to leave room for about 80 points. I went through the room. I asked them to read off some of the numbers by way of getting to know them. And then I asked them, do they know the secret to trading is? Well, here's the quick story is there is no secret, but there are ways to carve money out of the market. But most of the time, people will say to you, buy low, sell high. And that's in part right, and in part entirely incorrect. I'll explain. If it were so easy, why isn't everybody rich? I told the kids. So buy low, sell high. It's simple, right? I tell the guys, as we were filling out this line chart, I said, congratulations, you bought this very low print, and now we're at 0.8. And I said to these guys, what would you like to do here? You bought low, now sell high. Of the crew that were there, and there are about 12 people there, who wants to sell at 0.8 and take profit? Well, half the room said yes. So then I started to read off some numbers and to continue that line chart we were creating. I read them really quick, 40, 50, 71, 82, and hilarity ensued as they started to run off the page that they were working on. So some of them got quite upset. Go, this isn't fair, it's a trick. I go, I assure you, this is just price data I've pulled. Anyway, they said, it's not fair, you didn't have the scale, you didn't give us the scale. I go, oh, you wanted the scale ahead of time. Well, that's interesting, because that's not how life works. What defines high anyway, I said to the guys. We were at point A, now we're at point B. So half of you sold out way too early. Who wants to sell out at point B? Because that's a high number. Well, of the six remaining, half of them bowed out. And I said, okay, great, too bad. We went to point C. With three guys remaining, I said, anyone else want to take their profit at point C? So we're down to one guy that said he wanted to hold on. Went to point D. And I said, well, now you can finally let him have it, right? Well, yeah, he said, yeah, I can't take it anymore. I got to get out. Well, unfortunately for him, the real move hadn't even happened yet. So the guys that sold out point A, B, C, we're now looking at this chart in disgust. But this is the key point. Moves are always obvious when you're given the beneficial perspective of hindsight. And that's not something we have. I then tell them about water. And now there's three phases for water, solid, liquid, and gas. That's pretty standard, right? Now, just like water, for prices or for positions, and prices, there are three phases. You could be long, you could be flat, or you could be short. So when you pull up a chart, this is what it looks like when you just pull up a symbol. It knows the limits, the bottom range and the top range. So it can compute a scale and center it nicely for your viewing pleasure. This is how I look at it. And I'm going to show you how in a second. First of all, you're long when it's green, you're flat and it's blue, and you're short when it's red. So it's possible to be long, flat, and short and capture these moves as they're going along in a systematic and disciplined manner. This is another trick I like to do, is why not just take out the noise? So the bars that with no positions, I just turn them to neutral, or I just take the color out of them, make them white. Okay, so there are many ways to trade. I'm the first to say that. I've traded many different styles, but you can work off price data or fundamental data. And even within trend, there's many different ways to trade trend. So you really are going to have to do a lot of soul searching and investigation and research, but this is just one good way. What you can say with all the various strategies, there are two generally broad types. One is a convex strategy where you want things to happen. The other is a concave strategy where you do not want things to happen. Well, let's not talk about that. Some of the key trend trading concepts. Okay, most rookies, what they do is they get into a trade and it's a loser and they hope it comes back. And then they're in a winning trade and they're fearful that the next day they're going to lose all their profits. So what they tend to do is they tend to hang on to losing trades too long, and they tend to get out of winning trades too soon. That's not an attribute of a great trader. What a great trader wants to be is very disciplined, organized. He cannot have strong opinions. He gets out of his losers quickly, and he lets his winners run. Another name for this is ambivalent. So if you're risking just a small piece of your money on a trade, and you really don't care what happens, you are now in a position for success. And now, I don't mean to be callous, and ambivalent probably isn't quite the right word for this, because it's not that you don't care. I mean, you want to make money. The point is, you just can't get hurt, and you got to take a, sometimes it takes taking tactical losses in order to uncover the next great trade. Maybe a better word for this is dispassionate. Your trading should be dispassionate and, frankly, a little boring. So what is a trend anyway? A trend is pretty simple. It's a series of higher highs and higher lows, seen on this chart here, going from the bottom left to the top right. It's making higher highs and higher lows. And a downtrend is merely the mirror image of this, a series of lower lows and lower highs. And I'm always amazed at how some people just can't get that right. Now, it's common nature that we want to be right, but being right is way overrated. Take, for example, this series of seven losses in a row. We got seven losers ranging from 0.5% to 1.2% of your assets. Okay, so the seven losers, that didn't feel very good, but then you ended up, you had three winners. You had a decent winner, a medium-sized winner, and a fantastic winner. So the point here is that a couple of those big wins erase those losses, and then you're left with that big win. And that is exactly how trend following works. It's okay to have 30% winners. Most people guffaw. You hear people talk about 85% winners. That's generally not to be trusted. So what we've done here is we have 577 wins since we've been running this every minute over the last 5 or 6 years. We have 1,300 losses. Now, the losses average 60 basis points, and the winners are averaging 1.68%. So you see that we've covered the green wins and the red losses, which all neutralize each other, resulting with these big winners. And this is where all the profits are derived. Curiously, about six of those, I don't know if you can see the mouse, but six of these points up here, those were generated relatively recently during this move, this virus crisis move. Okay, why does trend trading work? It doesn't matter. Normally, I'll talk about ants, I'll talk about George Soros, but we don't have time for that. Here is one chart that's actually kind of noteworthy. Smart people do dumb things all the time. This was taken out of the Wall Street Journal. On this day, they said, where do you think we're going to be at the end of the quarter and at the end of the year? And well, they were all wrong. So smart people do dumb things. Even Isaac Newton, you may have seen this chart somewhere. Newton invests a bit, he exits happy. Meanwhile, his friends get rich. He gets in with a lot, and then the thing tanks and he exits broke. he exits broke, and he says, "I can calculate the movement of the stars, but not the madness of the men." So just a quick review there. Markets go up and down. Why miss out on half the fun? Calling tops and bottoms is foolish. Being right is overrated, and you are your own worst enemy. Here's how we are constructing the index. The rules should fit on the back of an envelope, and in each good trading system, you're going to need at a minimum to know what you're going to be trading, how much you're going to risk per trade, where you're going to get in, when you're going to get out at a loss, and when you're going to get out at a profit. Things to think about later. I don't even want to talk about that yet. It'll just be confusing. So here's what we're talking about: 8 different market sectors and all these various commodities. They're the ones that are most commonly traded and have a deep open interest on the exchanges. The next key concept we're going to talk is average true range. This is the typical range we can expect an instrument to trade from high to low on a given day. Now you stack those up and you take an average over some period, like 5 days or 20 days. We're using a 20-day average true range. Now back in December, the average true range in this is fresh. This is today's chart, okay, of the S&P 500. It used to trade 22 points from high to low on any given day. It adds up to 179 recently. It's 164 today. Yeah, this is a high volatile e-ticket ride environment. Now we use this ATR concept to determine where our initial hard stop will be when we put on a trade. And we also use it for calculating position size, which we'll discuss right now. So as markets as volatility increases or decreases, the ATR will automatically adjust for the different environment, as we just saw right here. This is an entirely different environment than it was months ago. And this ATR, it's widely available on most of your trading platforms. So what we're doing here is we're taking a $5 million account size. Now for most people, that is a lot of money, but for a sovereign wealth fund, that's a deck chair on the QE2. We chose 5 million because it's pretty easy to round up or round down as you need to suit your pocketbook. We're risking 50 basis points of AUM on every trade. So 5 million times 50 equals 5 million times 50 equals $25,000 in, let's call it, risk budget per trade. So if you lost 50 basis points per trade, you need to lose 200 trades in a row to be completely wiped out of money. And that doesn't seem very probable to go over 200. Now, the 25,000 goes into this column here. Now, let's focus on the bonds here. The ticker symbol is US. The average true range at this point in time was 1.20. It's $1,000 per point, which gives you $1,200 of risk. 25,000 divided by 1,200 will yield 20.8 contracts. But since you can't trade, you know, round lots, you need to either truncate that to 20 or move it to 21. And then, you know, we have an example here with gold. If gold is 19.3 is an ATR, and the tick value is $100 per point, it's 1930, 25,000 divided by 1930, we give 12 or 13 contracts per trade. So here we have a worksheet, and we can see what the current position is, what the 20-day ATR is, what the 40-day high low is, 40-day high and 40-day low is. And so we make that available on our website. So here we focus on trade initiation. Let's first identify the highest high of the last 40 days in blue and the lowest low of the last 40 days here. In a narrow market, when prices are not going anywhere, doesn't make any sense to make the bet which way it's going to go. Just let the market tell you which way it's going to go. So at this point, what we'd be looking to do is looking to buy if it goes over the blue line or get short below the red line. So we're looking for consolidation, then breakout. Here we see it moved below the lowest low of the last 40 days and a short was initiated. On this one, in this example, we go over the highest high of the last 40 days and a long was triggered. Now we know how many we're gonna do because we already computed that. The question then is, where are we gonna put our protective stop? Because we always have a protective stop in the market. We take our trade entry, and from that trade entry, we move down one of those 20-day ATRs. Now, that's pretty tight, I'll be honest. Some people will risk 3 to 5 to 7 ATRs to give that trade room. So the tighter it is, the more likely it is to get stopped out. The further away it is, you give yourself more room, but you need to trade smaller. So that's the trade-off. But in all cases, an initial protective hard stop is immediately entered. Now, in this case, what are the outcomes? There's only two outcomes, really. the hard stop could get hit. You know, you could maybe feel a little bit of love and the thing turns around and gets stopped out. As Jesse Livermore says in Reminiscences of a Stock Operator, a loss never bothers me after I take it. I forget about it overnight. But being wrong, not taking that loss, that is what does damage to the pocketbook and to the soul. And truer words were never spoke. You need to just get out, okay, at the loss. Now, in the case it's a good trade and it works to your advantage, what we're going to do is force the market to get us out. We're going to do that by using the lowest low of the last 20 days. And hopefully you can see this purple line. It starts to ramp up with time. It takes over for that initial hard stop. And at some point, you're going to lock in profits as that trailing stop advances. Now, it's going to get taken out at some point, but you got to make the market take you out. That's a key point. So here's, I pulled out some charts here with some current examples of trades. This is October 28th of last year. And hopefully you can see this little, the bars turn green as it gets triggered long. This is noted with an email that went out to our subscribers and on our website, and that's where it got long. That was on October 28th, 2019. Now, this trade eventually got stopped out. Hopefully you can see where it got long. Can you guys see that cursor? Here's where you got long. This, the little dashed blue line here is the dynamic trailing stop that's moving up. And then on October 25th of this year, that long got stopped out for a fantastic, reasonable profit. Now you left a little bit on the table, but you made the market get you out. Here's where this crisis kicks in and why things are so interesting today. Later that same day, it got short, 3180 in the S&P. So that is where it got short. We sent an email out to all of our people. We had talked about this. We said, wow, if it goes from long to short in a day, that's very rare, and it's usually not a very good sign for the underlying thing. But enough time had gone by. That's exactly what had occurred. So here's today's chart. You're still short from up there. The trailing stop is moving down. And despite the trillions that they've thrown at this global pandemic, you know, they're getting a bounce, but look out if they can't even get the 20-day low to be taken out. Anyway, that's just where we're at right now today. I took that a couple hours ago and added this shot in there. Okay, here's the next one. Here's crude oil currently in or around the same time. Here's a look at cattle. So during this recent move, it wasn't even stocks weren't even the biggest driver. I mean, it was a big driver, but stuff like the commodity-based currencies. Here's cattle, crude oil, long fixed income. So you can be long and short. You just need to make the market tell you which way to go. And to do that, you need to be very patient. I brought this chart up today because this is really interesting. We took out the highest high last 40 days today in gold overnight. When we're not running our systems, we're running our system from 7 a.m. to 3 p.m. every day. So it didn't take this out overnight. Gold was up something like 40 or 50 bucks overnight, and then it opened down 10 or 20 bucks. So that is remarkable. And it kind of brings to light one of the issues when you use a backtesting model. You gotta be very careful with the backtesting model, because according to this backtesting model, we should be in the trade. When we run this thing every minute, it's one of the benefits of running our model. Every minute of every trading day, we can account for slippage and skid in a more realistic way. Here's a move in Bitcoin, and this is using a different platform. If you go onto our website and you sign up, this I took today. There's a 1 minute profit and loss curve. At one point, the model was down some 4.5% or something, kind of came back a little bit. We show what the active markets are on the day. I took this from a really active day a couple months ago at 583% in silver. That says it traded 5.8 times a typical 20-day ATR. That's just not very common. So that's why it's highlighted in red. Then we've got copper and gold in there, etc. You take a look by all the open positions and how old they are by age. That's the days in trade column. and how much open trade equity there is in there. Now, sometimes we'll roll a position. So say you're up $100,000 in the position, it gets rolled. Now you're starting from scratch. That position could be down 50,000, but when you add in the other 100,000, you're still up 50,000 on the trade. This is an interesting look at the trade plotter showing reading left to right, all the positions, long, short, and flat by commodity. And here's a look at some of the trades on the day you can see on the site. And then the bottom chart is another histogram depicting the number of longs and shorts. We have something like 3,000 charts. Every time a trade goes off, we grab a snapshot and archive it. It goes out in the email at the end of the day. So we have this massive historical archive of the past 5 years of every trade. And that's again to create that accountability we talked about. So trading rules, it's to recap here, we're risking 50 basis points of AUM on a theoretical $5 million account size or $25,000 of risk on every trade. We're risking 120-day ATR. We're getting long over the highest high of the last 40 days, short below the lowest low of the last 40 days. The initial protective hard stop is from wherever you got triggered, plus or minus one of those 20-day ATRs. And then we're using a dynamic trailing stop using the 20-day lower high. And eventually that replaces the initial stop as this trade starts to develop out. We're not doing add-ons of winners and we're not taking partial profit. So feel free to plug those into your back tester and find out for yourself what things tend to work maybe better or maybe better suit your portfolio or your style of trade. Maybe think about different time frames even. So you could change each of these parameters, something that you can get into your system and change and play with and start to begin your journey into trend following. There's a look at the look back at the historicals, things to investigate. We just talked about you're gonna get a lot of things wrong, and each time you do, you're gonna be better off for it, says Thomas Edison. I know thousands of things that don't work. There's a look at the Android app. We had an earlier version. We're gonna roll out a new version that's also for Apple, but Apple doesn't play nicely with others these days. So we'll get on that really soon. But these are some of the things we show on the app. We also made a Twitter tape. That's a whole other discussion altogether. There it is in action. Remember, Isaac Newton, how would a trend follower have treated this? Well, it seems to me he would have got long in the breakout. He would have been long for a big chunk, maybe the whole way up. Near after it kind of backed off a little bit, he would have booked a profit on that. And then perhaps he would have gotten short and got them both coming and going. So don't miss a trend. Get the real-time trade signal alerts, get the transparency. It's a good comparison tool against other managers out there and learn the trend following technique. So I invite you to come 40and20out.com. The Twitter feed, we put a lot of good stuff out there, I think, or we try to at least. So open to questions. Thanks for your time. Well, we're still on here.
All
You
right,
there?
Andrew, thanks so much. We do have just a couple of minutes here, folks. If you want to type in some questions, we'll try to get those answered for you.
While you're rolling them out here, don't let money. I should mention the signals we send out are 10-minute delayed by exchange rules. Otherwise, you'd be paying thousands of dollars a month for real-time data feeds. So I should mention that that's by necessity. And I'll say this also, there is no excuse for not testing these concepts for yourself. There's plenty of free tools out there. We use R&R Studio and Quandl as sources. We'll probably do a seminar or a white paper about how you can use these free sources. For example, we pulled down some data, we drew some of the lines. Here's how it might look if you apply these techniques. So these are some various screenshots of things we've done, and we hope that you can take advantage and do those types of things for yourself.
All right, we did have a question here. They're wondering if your trend following rules would work for stocks, and if so, how would you adjust them?
Oh yeah. Now the trickiest thing with stocks are corporate actions. So depending on the system you're using, you know, there'll be dividends that you would be receiving if you were long or need to pay out if you were short. You also, if you're gonna go short, then you gotta build in the punitive loan costs to do so. You know, some, like if you want to get a short Tesla, they might charge you 15% juice or something like that to locate a short. So yeah, I'm a big fan of trend following on individual equities. Historically, trend following on equity indices is, this is going to sound silly, but it's historically been a really bad idea until it's been recently a very good idea. We definitely look at, we're not ready to roll it out, but we've been doing the same type of thing on a basket of 50 stocks, and we're not ready to share that with people at this time. But yeah, you can definitely use these techniques. Now, in stocks, there's a long bias out there that exists, and some people by mandate can't get short. So one of the things that you might want to investigate, and this is just a very strong suggestion, is when you can no longer be short, maybe that's when you take a look at getting long. You know, in the past couple of weeks, I've read, you know, nonstop about asset managers talking about the need to not time the market. And if you missed out on the best days, how your performance would go down. What they don't tell you is if you sidestep the very bad days, if you were able to sidestep the very bad days, your performance would go up even more. So when I can suggest, like, maybe don't take the short signal, maybe just take the long signals, and or take a look at what if I got long when I could no longer be short. That's also really powerful, something that I recommend you to investigate on your own, and then perhaps you can draw your own conclusions.
All right, thank you so much. We had someone wondering how it's best how to handle whipsaws.
You know, you just got to take it. That's why you're only risking 50 basis points of AUM. Hey, you know what? Let me go back to one of those recent examples. How do you handle whipsaw? Here's that current short position in crude. If you look to the far left, can you actually see my mouse on the screen, or does it show up?
Yes.
Did that? Okay, great. So you see there's this long here and out. Long here. And you know, you were sitting on some decent open trade equity and you got stopped out for, you know, a scratch or a small loss. That didn't feel very good. Then what happens is you just have to be disciplined enough to take the next trade. And that's where the dispassionate trading comes in. And that's what I found, at least. You know, maybe you can find some crazy filter that works for you. I have never been able to find something that really works in terms of a filter or whipsaw is going to happen. It's just now, having said that, the longer you do your window to look back, like this is a 40-day breakout. I talked to some of my peers, some of the actual turtles who I've got a rapport with, and you know, you might want to go out, say, 80 days or 100 days or 200 days. The further out you go, you kind of, the more confidence you get in the signal. So if you're worried about whipsaw, try expanding your window and looking farther back, because 40 days is awfully tight for many people. It's incredibly tight. And it just so happened that it was tight enough to catch this reversal that we saw over the course of the last month or two. So whipsaws happen. It's just, it's a cost of doing business is probably the best way of looking at it.